Ruben, welcome to the AWS Studio. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Why don't you start with telling us a little bit more about your background and role at AWS?
Of course. I'm a principal solutions architect. I'm working to advise, support, and help our customers transforming with the cloud. I work with several telecom and telecom customers, operators, ISVs. That's what I do.
Wonderful. I think let's just jump right into it. Tell us a little bit more about what confidential computing is and how does it work?
So let's say you are a telecom operator, a communication service provider, or an independent software vendor that's acting as a supplier. You are processing data from your workloads, the services, and also the end users to whom you are delivering the service. These data can be sensitive in nature. You might have text messages, call detail records, CDRs, or customer identifiers. And you want to be able to protect this data in transit, at rest, and also in use. So the protection of data in transit and at rest, these are well documented. Confidential computing is about protecting data while in use. And specifically at AWS, we define confidential computing as the use of specialized hardware with the associated firmware and software for the protection of data in use while being processed from unauthorized access.
And so how do we enable this within the AWS ecosystem?
Right. We have three key capabilities. One, we have the AWS Nitro system. Second, we have AWS Nitro enclaves. And we recently released the third capabilities, the Nitro Trusted Platform Module, TPM. So, before we explain, let me just take a step back because before we explain those three capabilities, let's talk about two important dimensions to better understand how we use them. When you talk about unauthorized access, you have to consider two dimensions. Dimension one is protection from the cloud operator. In the case of you working with AWS, it's protection from AWS, from us. You want to protect your data from us. Dimension two is protection from yourself as a customer. Let me give you examples. This can be an admin of your workloads. This can also be a supplier or a third party that has been contracted to do managed operations on your behalf. And this dimension two also covers the cases where you have a malicious admin, a malicious third party that's posing as an admin, right? So now let's get back to those three capabilities, because this is where you need those two dimensions. The AWS Nitro system is the foundation of all modern virtualization on AWS today. And it's addressing dimension one. With the AWS Nitro system, there is no operator access to your data or your code. Now, let's talk about dimension two. This is where AWS Nitro Enclave comes in. Nitro Enclaves are hardened, secure, and isolated computing environments. And they provide additional isolation capabilities than what the Nitro system can provide. So this is addressing dimension two. And finally, I mentioned we have the Nitro TPM. This allows you to attest on the health and integrity of your instances. And this is a TPM 2.0 standard compliant device.
So confidential computing alone, it's vertical agnostic, but let's talk about telco-specific workloads. What are you seeing and where do you think some of those early use cases ought to be?
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so as a telco, you are processing sensitive data. And you're processing, we've talked about text messages, call detail records, billing records, and so on. Now, let's think about dimension two, right? Protection from third parties or suppliers. So this is a very prevalent scenario for telcos because, first of all, it's a regulated industry. And they are working in the context of telecommunication acts that can require telecom data to stay within specific geographic boundaries and that do require telecom customers to take specific care and measures for the protection of this sensitive data. They're also working in an environment where they have suppliers or they contract third parties for operation. So you might be a global telco operator. You have operation teams that are working abroad. They might need to access a specific geography your workload, and you want to make sure that the data is appropriately protected. You might also have a managed service provider that's doing operation on your behalf. And again, you need to ensure compliance with the regulation. And so that's where Nitro Enclave offers an ideal combination, because you can safely protect sensitive data while doing maintenance operation, while having somebody from the supplier side coming in and maybe working on the workload for debugging purpose, for optimization purpose, and so on. One prevalent use case, or one way to look at it or to think about it today, is to look at Nitro Enclave as a cloud-native, software-based, custom hardware security module. For example, for the protection of cryptographic material, in the case of authentication on a 5G network, or the concealment of customer identifiers. Mobile networks today, their security is built on a lot of specific cryptographic operations, and the combination of the flexibility and the performance of Nitro Enclave is really ideal for this type of use cases. Beyond this, you can think about using Nitro Enclave for protection of all things security, certificates, for example, in the control plane of a 5G network, cryptographic material. Think of it to protect for the use of lawful intercepts, the processing of customer-specific data. Think about the text message that you may want to post-process for filtering purpose in case of phishing protection. And everything that falls under telecommunication acts, this is going to be appropriate.
One thing you mentioned specifically was cloud native, and it's the underlying 5G networks themselves become increasingly cloud native and containerized. How does the Nitro system play into a containerized environment?
Right. So the Nitro system. Let's talk a bit more about what are Nitro enclaves, right, and how they work. So we said Nitro enclaves are hardened, secure, and isolated computing environments. They are essentially highly constrained virtual machines. Their lifecycle, their existence, is tied to an EC2 instance. And we often talk about a parent instance. Now, Nitro enclaves they have no networking, they have no administrative access, they have no permanent storage. And the only way to access the enclave is via its parent instance. They're also coming with their own cryptographic keys. And from a software deployment point of view, we're basically using the Docker format to package applications for the enclave. Now, they are not containers, right? But we're using this format for its convenience and its developer friendliness. From a capabilities point of view, Nitro enclaves have really two key capabilities. One of them is an attestation mechanism. This can be used for the enclave to prove its identity, for example, to another service, and also to authorize what codes can run on the enclave. They also have a first-class integration with the AWS Key Management System, AWS KMS. And this combination is extremely powerful. Why is that? Because you can ensure, for example, that only an enclave has the ability to decrypt a specific piece of data that you might have encrypted. So from a value perspective, Nitro enclaves they can attest their identity, they can authorize codes, They're extremely flexible. We haven't really talked about this, but you can use them with Graviton, with Intel, with AMD CPUs, and you have a lot of flexibility into sizing them in terms of how much memory and computing resources you want to have. And they come at no additional cost. Right? So now let's to come back to really the cloud native. They essentially are interfaced into the rest of the AWS computing ecosystem. And that's a very powerful proposition. Now, if you really like containers, we recently released in November a plugin that allows to expose an enclave to Kubernetes pods. So that works either for EKS or for any other managed Kubernetes.
I think you covered the building blocks really well here of how Nitro system can apply more broadly to containerized applications and to existing AWS services and workflows at large. But let's maybe transition to applications. Somebody's going to ask, well, wait a minute, does this work for mission critical applications? Is that the right fit?
Yeah, it does, absolutely. Again, let's get back to what I said earlier about integration into the broader EC2 ecosystem. This is why it works. You can load balance and you can scale Nitro enclaves via their parent instance. You can automate their deployment and their lifecycle via continuous integration and continuous deployment using the same tools and the same ecosystem that you would use with EC2 or with EKS. From a performance perspective, they're also, as I said, they're also super flexible. You have the ability to decide how much memory you want to assign to them, how much computing power you want to assign to them.
So functionally, these enclaves, they're inheriting the best practices and value proposition of not only the parent instance, but the cloud itself.
Absolutely, completely.
So let's dive even deeper. Let's talk about an end-to-end use case, a telco-specific end-to-end use case. Walk me through what the problem, the customer problem would be, how Nitro Enclave solves that problem and the potential impact it could have.
Right. So let us talk about a scenario in the case of a 5G network, and specifically let's talk about a scenario where you want to protect the cryptographic material that's being used for mutual authentication. So we are going to dive a bit deep, maybe use a few acronyms. So we will unpack that. So what is mutual authentication? In a mobile network, the network wants to authenticate the user, the subscriber. Typically, that's going to be you and your mobile phone. It wants to make sure that you are authorized to use the network and that you are the right person, so to say. You have the right credentials. The other way around is as well true. As a user, you want to authenticate the network. You want to make sure that you're accessing the network you are expecting to access. That's what's called mutual authentication. Mutual authentication is based on the exchange of a set of cryptographic values called authentication vectors, or AVs. And the generation of these authentication vectors, those AVs, is based on cryptographic operation that is applied on a shared secret key that is available to both the network and the user. So when you start your smartphone, the smartphone is going to take this shared secret key within your SIM card, traditionally, and it's going to calculate the authentication vector. In the network, you have a database of shared secret keys, a highly secure database, onto which you are going to run cryptographic operations to generate as well an authentication vector. And if both values match, that's it. The user is and the network have authenticated to each other. Now, where do you need Nitro Enclave here? Now, come back to the dimension 2 protection from suppliers and third parties. This database of shared secret, it's highly sensitive, all right? This is cryptographic shared secret material that you want to protect. So in our use case, we've built a proof of concept where we are hosting the shared secret database along with the cryptographic operations within the Nitro enclaves. And this ensures that in case of maintenance operations, optimization operations, where a supplier or a managed service provider needs to access the workload, that this database of shared secret is always appropriately protected. And we've also been able to validate high availability via the load balancing of Nitro enclaves.
Really appreciate the depth there. I think it really appropriately characterized the security that this type of new model and architecture can enforce. But maybe as an exercise, let's think big, let's zoom out for a second. As we look at the future of Nitro enclaves on AWS and confidential computing more broadly, what does the next level of confidential compute for telcos on AWS look like to you?
It's about giving our customers the trust that they can operate in a safe and reliable manner their most sensitive workloads on AWS. This is really what we're working on.
So I'm ready to start building. Where should builders go to learn more about confidential computing? And then secondarily, for the enterprise and the business decision makers, what types of materials can they consume to learn more?
All right. So of course we have documentation on AWS Nitro enclaves. There is a workshop that's available online for anybody to just start and get to use Nitro enclaves, and it will give you all the necessary know-how and starting points so that you can start experimenting and developing with Nitro enclaves for your applications. If you're interested in the Kubernetes ecosystem, just go to GitHub and you will find the code as well as tutorial as to how to build your very first EKS cluster with the Nitro enclave, Hello World. So my recommendation is really try it out, build, experiment, and if you want to discuss more, reach out to us. What I also really want to emphasize is if you're interested more into the overall security of the AWS Nitro system, there was a white paper released in November. It's called the Security of the AWS Nitro System. I can really recommend it to anybody who wants to get a deeper look into the innards of it. It's fascinating.
I appreciate the reading list. Wonderful insights, great discussion, and thanks for joining the AWS Studio.
Thank you very much.